Hello. So I'm here today to present you a small-scale research we completed this year. So the research is published in a book, and it's called "Addressing Human Trafficking in the Baltic Sea Era." So I have plenty of time. I try to be short and up to the point. So the project we conducted together, actually, the main research team comes from HEUNI, from Helsinki. Helsinki Institute for Crime Prevention and Control affiliated with United Nations. So me, myself, from Estonia, from University of Tartu, participated in this research, and a colleague from NGO called Providence from Latvia, Sanita Sila. So this is our research team. And the aim of our research is rather, I would stress it, rather small research, was to look at the situation with trafficking in the Baltic Sea area, and our main goal to advance prevention of trafficking. So we wanted, in order to do so, in order to design some training seminars for public sector, namely for ferry companies. So we had a goal to map the current situation, and also to map the understanding of trafficking and awareness of trafficking issues. And also we wanted to see what's already there, what has been done on both sides, on public and on private side to address the issue. So here we just present our research questions, and we try to be as simple as possible. And so first we wanted to look at the routes of transportation and to see what are the possibilities for trafficking there. We also wanted to see some links between different forms of mobility and trafficking. For example, we know that a lot of migration for labor is going on between Baltic states and Scandinavian countries. So just I traveled this morning by plane from Tallinn, so half of the plane actually. My guess would be the constructor workers or construction workers from the Baltic coming to Norway. So our goal was to see whether it is possible to identify victims of trafficking on the ferries, because ferries are used as a means of transportation and means of trafficking. So, to identify victims, you need to notice the phenomenon. So the awareness of the phenomenon is very very important. So one of our goals was to see what the people in the ferry industry are aware of, and to see, actually, to be very frank, because we are talking about private sector, to see why they should care about prevention of trafficking, and actually how can they benefit from prevention of trafficking. So what is their role, and but also what are the benefits? So because we are always talking about private sector, we are often talking in terms of what can they get from it. And so what we like three areas what we've been looking for is because as a team we've been doing a couple of bigger research projects on trafficking for labor exploitation, and we often came like it's just the fact that people are traveling here using ferries. So this was one of the contexts we looked at this at the Baltic Sea. So the second one was actually not so much planned by us initially, but it came out from the interviews we conducted, mostly with public sector, with law enforcement, and this is in relation to irregular migrants and smuggling of migrants. And the third one is trafficking in the context of sexual exploitation, because there are some media reports that fairies are used for prostitution, some like sex-related scandals. So this was also one of our areas we looked at. So the data, what we did? We did desk research, looking through all the court cases, if possible, media reports we found. We conducted a mini survey. Initially, we planned to conduct exit poll in the harbor area, but we didn't manage to get agreement with ferry companies to do so. So we decided to go to the ferries, and we conducted mini survey with the ferry staff, not with people who travel. But the vast most of the information we got from interviews, and so here you can see that we interviewed 39 people. From both from private side and from the authorities, from NGOs, mostly in Finland. So 20 interviews we conducted in Finland, 9 persons interviewed in Estonia, 6 in Latvia, and also 4 in Sweden. So survey we used like 2 ferries and. Did one survey on the route Helsinki-Tallinn, and also another one on the route Helsinki-Stockholm. So we've got a sample of 60 workers, which was pretty good, something like half of all the staff who were involved on those ships answered our questions. As I mentioned, so we have 2 sites here, private or point of view of private companies. So I deliberately do not mention what ferry companies participated in this study. So to be frank. What is noticed here, when we are talking with law enforcement, mostly with border guards, so the main concern is the border. So they raise the issues related to border crossing, and they would like to have as much control as it's possible and even impossible. On the same side, we have private companies who are trying to be most efficient. We have very high competition in the Baltic Sea areas. It's like living in Tallinn. We have ferries living every hour from Tallinn to Helsinki, and there are like 4 companies or even 5 companies operating in the area. So the competition is very high, and we are talking like. About very, very short boarding time. So, and ferry companies are interested in being very efficient and proceed all the passengers very quickly. So, the boarding time for several thousands of passengers is something like 20 minutes, not more. And all, like both sides, been reporting that they have very good cooperation and so they would like to enhance it. While mapping the situation, we came to all these links to trafficking. So trafficking is our main issues. So the first one is like indirect link. Ferries could be used as a means of transportation of traffic persons as well as people who are smuggled, irregular migrants. And for example, law enforcement reported also involvement of organized crime. So it's not ferry per se is is like responsible, but it's used as a means of transportation. Second one is, as I mentioned, only direct link. It's first of all when sexual exploitation is taking place aboard the ship. The second one, which is maybe not so visible, is when ferries are using labor through subcontracting chains. So we have labor exploitation on the like bottom of those chains. For example, it could be cleaning sector or something related to food processing, etc., etc. And the third one, the third framework, which is also important, maybe it's the point of like ideas and thinking for private sector, for fair companies, it's corporate social responsibility. And so when we are talking about trafficking, we are talking about criminal offense and its obligation of private sector as well to prevent or to react to this situation. I mentioned that private sector can actually benefit from it to increase benefit from prevention by increasing security, but also being responsible, socially responsible company to increase prestige of the company. With several companies, we have this agreement of security and security codes, trafficking and prevention of trafficking is not mentioned in the code. So this is maybe just one small step as to include awareness and readiness to prevent trafficking, to identify victims to those codes. So we can talk about human rights approach. Trafficking is human rights violation, and we should support the trafficking efforts of fair companies. So I have here a very good example from Estonia, from my country, of cooperation between private public sector in order to prevent trafficking. So this could be used as one of the models. So we have an NGO, Living for Tomorrow, who is mainly involved in prevention of human trafficking. They are also holders of hotline, like assisting victims of human trafficking. And with victims of trafficking, one difficulty which is related to identification of victims is that they themselves are trying to avoid any contact with authorities. First of all, not identifying themselves as trafficking. So the typical, if you are, for example, victim of sexual exploitation, so it's like self-blaming and shaming, etc., etc., involved. If we are talking about victims of labor exploitation, we are talking about people thinking, I've been so stupid, it's a shame, I will not tell anyone what has happened to me, how can I believe those promises and to be in such a trap. So one of the task is not only like raise the awareness of people around, but also awareness of victims. So this NGO, Living for Tomorrow, in cooperation with authorities and with our social ministry, had a series of seminars aboard the ship. So the, when you travel from Tallinn to Helsinki, for example, if you take morning ferry to Helsinki, you have thousands of people going to work there. And they have, like, they're traveling for 2 hours, and this time could be used to approach them. So this was a kind of approach. The ferry companies cooperated. They allowed this NGO together with Minister of Social Affairs to have seminars aboard. So they provided coffee to attract more people to the seminars. On those seminars, like they've been very practical. So if you if something is happening to you, you can look for assistance. So those are the telephone numbers, etc. So this is just one of the like very easy and practical ways for cooperation. So when we go to findings, and I have also some quotation from interviews here to describe the situation. So we have a lot of people traveling for labor, and so we also have victims of trafficking there. These promise contracts who are not paid their salaries, who will work 12 hours a day without any break, etc. So this is what was noticed by field workers, and here is a quotation of one NGO representatives. But as is the case of irregular migrants, these victims of trafficking, it's also very often they're avoiding authorities. Sometimes they're working illegally, sometimes there's something wrong with their taxes. So they're not approaching and even avoiding authorities. So you need to ensure very safe treatment and not to harm victims anymore. So we, as I mentioned, we had this very small survey. Later on, you will see the graph and the possible answers to the questions. We asked ferry staff whether they ever encountered any suspicious situations aboard the ferries, and something like 30%, one third of them. I told that they had this suspicion of prostitution aboard. So the quote is here a couple of times. There has been prostitution, not very often, but the suspicion that perhaps it could be. Also domestic violence against a woman. And they've noticed that the woman does not want to talk, she's afraid. This kind of characteristics, as something is, you know, not what it should be. So this is just a report of their personnel. So the growing concern from mostly from authorities, law authorities, is smuggling of migrants. So in previous presentation, we've seen this Russian route. So among law enforcement officers, this concern that some Baltic route is possible. Also, there's no like big scale migration or trafficking of irregular migrants. So the law enforcement noticed some growth in numbers, and also, as I mentioned, involvement of organized crime groups. So this is also mentioned by some staff members. So there have been some cases with a completely mixed group, and none of them have any papers. No one talks anything, and sometimes there's no common language. And then it is there. Is they refuse to provide any information. Some even one of forms of human trafficking, which was discussed lately by another project, is related to sham marriages. So also it's very indirect, but there was a case reported from Latvia that fear was used as a ground for fixing such marriages. But one of the main concerns related to identification of victims trafficking or smuggling of migrants is related to checking IDs. And because the Baltic states or this Baltic Sea region and their routes that we are discussing are part of Schengen area. So actually checking of IDs is not what should happen in this area. But law enforcement is very, very concerned about a lot of people traveling from one country to another and without any valid ID. So they would be in favor of checking these IDs and knowing people who are going from one country to another. So this is this would identify victims, but it mostly would help to identify smuggling or migrants who are smuggled. This technical progress, I don't know, so when you used to travel just a few years ago, when you go to harbor area, you need to check in. So, and while checking in, you are showing your identification documents, so your passport or IT card, etc. And here's another example of good cooperation between law enforcement and private sector. From interviews in Italy, we've got this information that actually law enforcement is training those checking people how to identify false documents or enforce ID. And this was actually very useful, and they find that it is very helpful for law authorities, and also for companies are very thankful for this, because it's the securities, and then they do not know the list of passengers. So if something will happen, some accidents will happen to the ship, so they should have this list of passengers. So when people are traveling with false IDs or without IDs, with somebody else's IDs, so this is a threat to security. So, but what is the challenge? The challenge is that now you have this electronic check-in, also in harbor areas. So there's no possibility to check at the moment when people doing check-in. So there's more and more struggle for security aboard, who are checking IDs, not on a regular basis, but as I told, so they do some sample of passengers and then get some ideas. I mentioned cooperation. Actually, we assessed cooperation between private and public sphere, but we also assessed cooperation between different countries in the Baltic Sea region. And so our assessment that this is quite good, so all were satisfied. For example, the project Turnstone was mentioned several times. This is cooperation between law enforcement in different countries of the Baltic Sea region. But also some examples I already mentioned between cooperation between private and public sector, which was successful. What is expected here? There's always more cooperation the better, law's enforcement is interested that any irregularities noticed aboard would be reported. And so they stand that they do not want any action taken actually by the ferry staff, but they want some information. Ferry staff, on the other hand, are interested in some feedback. So they are ready to provide information, but they also would like to see whether it has some effect or not, whether it was useful or not. So this is the thing they do is having some effect. Okay, this is just some quotes from the interviews. So one is from law enforcement official in Estonia. People who have been working for the ferry companies many years, they see people every day who are traveling. They have this kind of sense of know-how to see that something is not right. The level of informing the police or border guard officer is not so high because many times they think that, okay, this is not normal, but they wouldn't inform anybody. So this information doesn't go. Or some very personal from Finland, other side, a couple of times a year, they, police, border guards, or customs, could come here and together we could go through if some criminal cases have been concluded and what judgments have been given. What use the information we gave them had been. The point give us additional motivation to do so. So, and here I promise that I show you a picture of the survey. So this was like a really brief survey, like of 2 pages. And we asked about any kind of irregularities staff members noticed aboard. So the lists here, for example, the most often they have noticed that the passenger who seems disoriented or confused is aboard. So the idea why this was included that when we are talking about victims of trafficking, so they are not making any decision by themselves, they are controlled. So this could like, betray the situation and maybe it's worth to pay attention to it. However, we should be very cautious about this 78%, as some staff members also explained in the questionnaires. So this confusion could be related also to not knowing language or to traveling for the first time. So they gave such example, for example, that there was a couple of people who traveled for the first time, been very confused, they didn't know how disembark from the ferry, and actually it took so long for them to find out that the ferry started to move back in another direction. So this could be one of the reasons, but also some
What's the average time span here? How long time are we talking about?
We are talking. Have you ever?
Ever.
Okay. Yes. So it's not really like very scientific research.
Yes. Because I guess some of the staff has worked there 1 week, some has worked 5 years.
So we also took this how long you've been working here. So it's several years. It's not so long. Maybe a little bit longer for security managers. But if you are talking about shop assistants, etc. So we had this question about experience. So we are not talking about that those are exactly the victims, but those are some irregularities and disturbances that may be noticed by staff members. So we already mentioned this one-third notice the situation of suspicion of prostitution, of sexual abuse on board. Passengers who seem to have been exploited or abused by a fellow traveler. In this regard, we quite often had some explanation related to domestic violence, for example. So also be careful here, but it's also they have some measures in place. Fair companies have some measures in place if they notice, for example, a case of violence. Male against female, so they have a possibility to separate two and to provide female with cabin and to keep her safe and also to keep aggressor also locked and then they call police. They notice there are some passengers who seem scared of the authorities and just avoid or not looking at the authorities or trying to avoid any contact with even staff. A passenger who seem to be controlled by a fellow passenger. Also sometimes it's like in interpersonal relations between male and female. So in this explanation, for example, there was sometimes husband is taking all the decisions for female. So, and to notice, so we asked what they're doing if they notice this situation, and whether there are some rules in place, do they know what to do? And they usually react, so they approach passengers. And they also notify another staff member, usually it's somebody on the top, and they also notify security. So the federal security is very helpful here. This is also a practice if something like very, so they have suspicions that there's a crime, it's like domestic violence I mentioned, or some ordinary crime like, I don't know, something happened in the bar, or there's a theft, etc. So they have this practice that they call police, and police will be in the harbor when they arrive. And the same goes for illegal smuggling of migrants, for example. And only 14%, that means that we questioned 60 persons, so 7 of them answered that I didn't do anything. So usually people react to those situations. What are the expectations? So we have like two sections. One was related in this small, really small questionnaire. So one was related to identification of victims, and the second part of this questionnaire was related to training. So, and we asked whether staff would be interested, or maybe it's so far away from them, they do not want to spend any time on this. But actually, people would like to know more, to learn more. Some of them also commented on the question that if I know more, maybe I will notice more as well. If you got very positive response from staff, usually awareness of that something went wrong is in the country of destination. But while you are trafficking, you do not know what will happen to you. And so this is a challenge. So the victim is not victim yet, but possible victim. So this is why we could use it for prevention. Just if something will happen, just be aware of the possibilities, and so here are the rules you can follow. Also, if some people are aware that they are traveling for illegitimate purposes, they're trying not to attract attention. So, as one example from a previous research, mostly related to air trafficking, but for example, when I was talking to ladies who were smuggled for prostitution, or the advice they've been given that you never wear makeup when you cross borders, that you should look as ordinary person, so not attract any attention. You should not be attractive. So this is just one example from a few years ago. So, but if we are talking about some people who are traveling against their will, so it's a little bit easier to notice. We have some points. So still we have this check-in. And it is used now to check documents, ideas. So we have like a bottleneck for the ship is embarkation or disembarkation, and it is also used by security guard to check some documents. Again, one quotation from interview I conducted with security manager. So they, for some people, they notice something suspicious going on. And for example, people are traveling every day. So this, like, I've seen this guy 15 times for last month. What he's doing, he's just traveling. So there should be something about him. So I will check the documents. I will stop him. I will check the documents. So this is how they are profiling. They just notice some people. And also on board, probably the best what we can do is to train some staff who are serving passengers. It's like in the bars or like shop assistants or those who are like serving the cabins, who see and who meet these people. Just to tell them and to train them how to notice some dangerous signs. Who could be trained? So this is check-in personnel or security staff. As I mentioned, hotel and restaurant staff. Some personnel at the information desk. So then somebody will turn to them for this question. But also, we think that management of ferry companies is just to raise awareness and to talk about corporate social responsibility and different approach to the issue. So we think it's also maybe a different kind of training, but training is also possible and needed. What would be our recommendations? So, people would love to have some concrete indicator and examples of trafficking. So, how to do it, what to notice, and so some cases. What is typical behavior by victims and perpetrators? How to identify behavior that might raise suspicion? So, or what to do, when to take immediate action, or as, for example, law enforcement officers told that sometimes when we would like to discover this trafficking chain or smugglers chain, we do not want to take any action. We just would like to have information and let traffickers go further, because we do not want just somebody, some guys on the bottom, so we can reach the top of this scheme. How to understand behavior better of passengers what they can do. So what is the chain of code, to whom to turn, what to do, etc., etc. Regarding cooperation, we think that cooperation exists, and this is a positive result of our studies. There are very excellent examples of cooperation between companies and law enforcement, and between different countries as well. But it's always can be better, according to the wishes of both sides. So we noticed that concrete feedback, so you just cannot require information, give nothing back to people. So people would like to be treated nicely. For example, if there are some new tools, identification, questionnaires, or assessments, etc., so it should be shared with staff. And sometimes, I'm talking mostly about Estonia, but this is an example I got from interviews. Sometimes the training is already in place. For example, law enforcement has its training for personnel who is working at check-in. So maybe when we are designing some special and new training, we should take into account the existing system. We do not need to introduce something new and which is out of system. Maybe we can contribute. So each side can contribute to what is already there. Corporate social responsibility, we think it is important, and this is the way to go, and this is how private sector can benefit from this preventive work. So we need commitment by management. We need to map the risk and that it is harmful for the companies. And we would like to see, actually, so some stuff we are just surprised that this is not included. And the corporate policies related to the staff code of conduct. So we would like to see some issues related to identification of victims and prevention of trafficking there. And also adopting monitoring mechanism as a means of managing risk and reputation, including designated person or groups that oversees the monitoring. And just some conclusions. It seems so at some point of research we are looking, what we are looking for, so this not trafficking, and we're trying to find something that doesn't succeed with this not trafficking, it's just a transfer. We think it is a very quite important issues. So my personal idea is that something which are problematic, for example, all parts of the world, we have such a mass of people traveling and being there, so we cannot identify victims, we cannot grasp this mass at once, but at the same time, it could be used as advantage. So if you have a mass of people concentrated in one place, so just use it for prevention. So that just use it for sharing some information on very useful numbers. So you go to the bar, you have these triangles with risky ads. So just have those triangles with useful phone numbers. For victims and stuff like this can actually work. So I would like to thank you for your attention.
Are you aware of any legal obstacles preventing ferry companies putting in place the same ID checks as airlines have?
So it was mentioned in several interviews this is ideal situation how law enforcement. I'm sorry. So this is the idea and situation how law enforcement sees this, it is not possible with this mass of people. So it's it jeopardizes competition between ferry companies, and they will not go for it because it takes so much time.
Wouldn't you assume that maybe some of the staff at the ferry companies actually cooperate with the traffickers?
It was never mentioned by any law enforcement official as a risk. So it and it was not mentioned by any because we like it was in the interviews. We've been talking to captain or two captains of two ferries and like security managers and like nobody mentioned it. Theoretically, it probably could be, but my guess is that there, in this case there also will be some indicators like coming from court cases or coming from law enforcement.
Thank you.